Robert W. Levenson received his PhD from Vanderbilt University in clinical psychology. He's currently a professor in the Department of Psychology at the University of California, Berkeley, where he's a member of the Clinical Science, Plasticity, Change and Development, and Social Personality Programs. I also developed a need for reading glasses. Much better. He currently serves as director of the Institute for Personality and Social Research and is the past director of the Clinical Science Program and the Bay Area Postdoctoral Training Program in Affective Science. His research program is in the area of human emotion, studying the organization of physiological, behavioral, and subjective systems. His research program is in the ways that these systems are impacted by neuropathology, normal aging, and culture, and the role that emotions play in the maintenance and disruption of committed relationships. His research has been supported by NIMH and NIA, including a merit award from NIA. He's past president for the Society of Psychophysiological Research, past president of the Association for Psychological Science, APS, and current president and the board of directors of the Psychological Clinical Science Accreditation System. He received the inaugural Mentor Award for Lifetime Achievement from APS in 2013, the William James Award for Lifetime Achievement in Basic Research from APS in 2014, and the Distinguished Scientific Contributions to Psychophysiology from the Society for Psychophysiological Research in 2015. So it's great pleasure to welcome Dr. Bob Levenson.
Thank you so much. Really is an honor to have this chance to talk to you. I'm a relative newcomer to this field, what I'm going to be talking to you today is about some of the basic laboratory science that we've done relevant to caregiving and how we think that it might provide, or we hope that it would be provide useful links to the kind of work that many of you do and Dolores is going to be talking about. So we start with this thing that is, of course, well known to all of you, and that is that when you think about dementia and you think about caregivers, you're talking about people who are on a shared journey. And I know my dear colleague Howard Rosen's already spoken to you about the person with dementia and the journey that they're on and the exciting science and understanding that's going on. A lot of it being done here in the Bay Area about the different kinds of dementia, the causes, the paths that they take, and hopefully soon the cures, the things that will slow down the neurodegeneration. Right now, on that path, there are no cures. Now, the other side is also an interesting and complicated side, and this is the side that you are familiar with and I'm going to talk about our own work with. The group data are pretty dire in terms of expectations for health and well-being for caregivers. Rates of depression can be up to four times that of age match controls. Anxiety disorders are common. In the realm of physical health, caregivers often become physically impaired. They have shorter lifespans, the elevated risk for dementia themselves. In laboratory studies, they have measurable declines in immune functioning. And the question on this side of the journey, though, is this preventable and is this treatable? And how I got interested in this is we were doing collaborative work with Howie and the other scientists at UCSF for about 15 years now, studying emotional functioning in individuals with dementia, and everyone would come to our lab at Berkeley accompanied usually by a familial caregiver. And we started assessing the caregivers for depression and general health. And this is a group of 107 caregivers who came to Berkeley in a sequence, so it's not, and these are their CESD scores. And if you're familiar with the standard depression inventory, a score of about 16 is considered to be the cutoff for clinical depression. And sure enough, you'll see in that red box that there are lots of caregivers who are quite depressed. But there were also a lot of caregivers who were not. In fact, we had about 5% of our population reported no symptoms of depression. And if you look at this, kind of step back, it's kind of a normal distribution that's sort of skewed to the left. There's a huge amount of variability, and even if we control for things like the severity of the, how far progressed the patient is, we still find that there are lots of differences in caregivers. Put away the data for a second and engage in the conversations that we engaged in, and caregivers are very different. Some of them are sort of feeling in charge and that they're getting through this and they have the resources they need, and others are feeling totally overwhelmed and almost hopeless. And so as a psychologist, that variation is what caught our attention. And it raises three big questions that have driven our research. First, what happens to the people with dementia when the caregivers get sick? The second is, why do some caregivers get sick while others do not? And then the third, and I think this is the purpose of today, is what can be done to protect caregivers' health? And is there anything that can come from the kind of science that we do that will be helpful to people who are working on the front lines? So let me answer those questions quickly and give you an idea of what our research has suggested. One study that we did recently, it was published last year, is we had almost 200 caregivers of individuals with dementia and other neurodegenerative diseases who we recontacted and found out how long the person in their care had lived after we assessed them at Berkeley. And then we did what's called a survival analysis, very commonly done in medicine. And we looked at how long the average patient survived prior to death as a function of how the mental health of the familial caregiver. And this is what it looks like. You can see these two charts are very, very different. The people who where the caregivers are in good mental health, the solid line, they just live a lot longer. In fact, it turns out that in our sample, that if you are cared for by a family member who's in the top quartile of mental health scores, you will live about 14 months longer than if you're cared by somebody who's in the lower quartile. And that's after controlling for everything that we know that might influence survival in the individual with dementia, severity of disease, income, resources, social support. So it seems like, you know, and this you see in the literature, and I'm sure you all know that when a caregiver gets sick, whether it's depression or anxiety or physical illness, it becomes more and more burdensome and harder to keep up. And sometimes decisions are not as sharp and appointments get missed, and this is a tangible effect. So it made us realize that there's a big picture here that, from a scientist's point of view, where we thought we might have something to contribute. On the far left are all of the things that we know from the literature affect the risk of caregivers for health, for the adverse health consequences. You know, external stressors are things like low education, low income, bad insurance, and things like that. And then different characteristics of the person with dementia, behavioral symptoms are known to be much more depressogenic in caregivers. We're very interested in the caregiver-patient relationship and whether we can see signs there of stressors. And then the caregiver themselves comes into caregiving with different personalities, different resiliencies, different vulnerabilities. And we're hoping that we can create a kind of a risk index where we can quantify these things and understand when a person comes into caregiving whether they're the kind of people who really are at high risk for these adverse consequences. Interventions, once you have an idea of who might be vulnerable and you start to understand what that vulnerability does, how it changes the behavior and the biology of the caregiver, those become targets for interventions. And we believe that if you can intervene early enough with the people particularly in need, you may be able to interrupt these downstream consequences, keeping the caregiver healthier for longer, and thus being able to keep the patient alive longer as well. And of course, that'll make a huge difference when new treatments come online. And people who, if we can keep people alive and available for these treatments, this is going to make a huge difference. So that's how we think about this from our point of view. And what we do is we bring caregivers to our laboratory at Berkeley. And I believe this is still kind of unusual. There are not a lot of places in the country where this is being done. And they come for half a day, and we assess their emotional functioning by showing them films and study their interaction with the person with dementia. We measure their physiological responses. And what I'm going to just share with you in this talk are just two of the little factors that we found in the laboratory that we know are warning signs for bad outcomes in caregivers. This is the kind of thing that you probably wouldn't look for normally in clinical practice, but it's a very simple thing. When people look at a disgusting movie, they look away. It's part of our kind of defense system. This is an individual with fairly advanced dementia, and looking at the film, understanding completely what was going on, but not finding it so distressful that they look away. We can quantify that. It's a measurable sign. And people who don't look away, we find their caregivers are much more likely to develop depression and other kinds of mood disorders. So this is a little molecule of behavior that we think is an indicator of the general breakdown of emotional functioning that becomes stressful for the caregiver. This is another study where we looked at pronouns. We had caregivers and patients talk for 15 minutes, 10 or 15 minutes in the laboratory about problems that they were encountering. And we then transcribed the conversations, and this is very simple, something you could do in your practice. We counted pronouns, you pronouns, and we pronouns. So let me show you what it looks like. This is a transcript, and we go through it, and we find the yous and the I's and the we's, and we count them up, and the finding is that when caregivers in these conversations, the less we's they use, the more depressed the caregiver gets. And it's mediated by increases in loneliness. Interestingly, the more I's the person with dementia uses, and the more you's the caregiver uses. So the more pronouns that point at the patient or the person with dementia, the more depressed the caregiver gets. And again, this is all mediated by increasing loneliness. So our idea in terms of real-world implications is that we can use these kinds of little things that we can measure in the lab, develop ways that we can bring them out into the community and make them available to other people to measure and assess, and give us new ways of knowing who the caregivers are who are most likely to develop psychological and physical health problems. We also think that by doing this, we can intervene early, doing the kinds of things Dolores is going to talk about, and maybe slow down, keep caregivers healthy, which is going to enable them to make good decisions and provide the best quality care for the people in their care. And then lastly, the possibility that maybe from these little molecules, they'll give us ideas for new kinds of interventions that are really focused. So someone comes in and they say, well, you know, they have this visual avoidance molecule, and we know that that's going to make them anxious, so maybe we'll have a very focused early intervention around reducing anxiety. And maybe that will enable us to be more efficient and more kind of narrow band and targeted in our interventions. So I want to thank you very much for inviting me and all the many people who work on this research, and it's wonderful to be part of this community. Thank you.